Diabetes has become so common in India that virtually every family has to learn to deal with it. But is it really so difficult to live with diabetes? To tell you more about this, we have a distinguished panel of stalwarts for you today, who between them have a combined experience of more than 100 years of helping their patients with diabetes lead healthy and normal lives. So to my left is Professor Subhankar Chaudhary, who is the Chief of Endocrinology at PGI Kolkata. Dr. Subhash Wanganu, respected senior endocrinologist, currently at Apollo Hospitals, New Delhi. Professor Zargar from Srinagar, who was the director of the Sher-e Kashmir Institute. And Dr. Shashank Joshi, the president of the Endocrine Society of India from Bombay. So we really have lots of wisdom in this panel today. And I will start first with Dr. Subhankar Chaudhary. Dr. Chaudhary, in so many years you've treated thousands of patients, what are the common reactions that you get from your patients when they're diagnosed with diabetes first?
Well, the reactions obviously vary depending on the personality, but we do see certain patterns. And one of the first reactions quite often is disbelief, denial. And I do remember clearly not too long ago, a senior politician of the city was given a diagnosis of diabetes with a glucose of 300 thereabouts. He immediately lodged a complaint with the lab saying, "You must be wrong. I can't have diabetes." So that is one of the first reactions. Having once the diagnosis sort of sinks in, quite often people tend to get a bit dismayed. Why me? Especially amongst the younger groups, we do see, why not my friends? Why I am only affected with diabetes? And then sometimes there is a feeling of anxiety, how to deal with it, sometimes anger. And for families with a small child diagnosed with diabetes, sometimes it's the parents who have a feeling of guilt, or they tend to blame themselves. So there's different types of reactions.
So really, as they say, attitude determines everything. And really, how you face up to your diabetes initially will determine a lot of how you will go on in your life with diabetes. So there's a lot of varied reaction, Dr. Wanganu, as you're well aware. What do you think? Why do people react like that?
The main reason is basically the lack of awareness. Education. People don't know that if they develop diabetes, they can live happily as long as compared to the non-diabetic counterparts if they control their diabetes very well. So awareness, and education about diabetes, that it can be managed very well without letting the patient to do something different.
So essentially, we don't let the diabetes control us. We need to control the diabetes.
Absolutely. That's a very good message. We need to control our diabetes, not let diabetes control us. I think, Dr. Zargar, you know, many times we've all seen that patients are as scared of the medicine as they are of the disease itself. So tell me, when does one really start medication in people with diabetes?
You know, in general, in most of the cases, common garden variety type of type 2 diabetes, we give a try to lifestyle change for 6 weeks to 3 months and see how the blood sugars behave. And if after that period we make a decision that blood sugars have not normalized or they are not there where we want them to be, then we have no choice but to start with medication. But there will be many situations where we will have to make this decision much earlier than wait for those 3 months for lifestyle change. Somebody having very high blood sugar, as Subhankar was just now saying, somebody having a fasting blood sugar of 300, you will not wait that long. Or somebody having type 1 diabetes mellitus, you are talking about an emotional impact of youngsters having diabetes, kids having diabetes. There we do not have that latitude of waiting for that and straightway starting on medication. Or women who develop diabetes during pregnancy, gestational diabetes, and then there isn't that huge latitude and a lot of time to wait for lifestyle changes to take place and give control of their diabetes. So we might have to shorten the decision of giving drugs to such patients. But in most of the common garden variety patients, after 3 months, we make a decision, is lifestyle sufficient or we need to add on drugs.
And there's a very common myth among the patient, "Doctor, why I need to be on the drugs?" "Oh, I won't start because once you are on drug, you are on lifelong drugs."
Yes.
Can't it be controlled with the just diet and exercise? There's a commonest belief among the minds of the VS patients.
So I think the point being brought out very well is really that medicines are an ally. They are tools to help us conquer diabetes or control diabetes, as we were saying. They are not our enemies. Diabetes is the enemy. Medicine will help us control that in conjunction with other things that Dr. Joshi is going to tell us about. Is it only about medication, Shashank? I mean, you know, really, diabetes, medicine, what is your take on that?
So, Amrish, you're very right. It's not just about medicines. It's actually a myth that diabetes is equal to medicine, as Subhash was saying. I think it's about motivation. It's about monitoring and medicine. So, I think the three M's are motivation for good lifestyle adherence. Cutting the food, doing physical activity, monitoring regularly the glucose level, the lipid levels, monitoring regularly, going to the doctor regularly itself is monitoring. And then comes medicines. Medicine are an integral part of diabetes management, but I think motivation as well as monitoring are equally important or probably more important in the long-term commitment for controlling diabetes and living happily with diabetes. See, it is important to recognize that a patient should not get distressed that I have diabetes, my world has ended.
Yes.
In fact, he should smile, live happily with diabetes, and live long.
Yes,
in fact, I think people who monitor and are motivated live longer than normal individuals.
Yes.
It's not just a matter of giving a tablet or not giving a tablet. It's a matter of achieving a good glycemic control.
Yes.
So long as lifestyle alone helps you to do that,
absolutely.
So long as you remain motivated in that segment, is fair enough. But we also know as clinicians of that collective 100 years experience you talked about, that a big chunk of people down the line at some stage would need some medical help.
Yes.
And that should not be poor. That needs to be.
Absolutely. So a judicious combination of lifestyle and medication, keeping in mind that the targets are met. So when you meet your physician, talk about what goal you need to achieve. And look at those numbers and see if you're actually achieving those goals with whatever measures you're taking. Don't run away from medication. And coming to an even bigger point here, you know, when we talk of medication for diabetes, the pictures that, you know, that the mind conjures up are always of insulin and injections and, you know, boiling syringes and all those things. Should it be the first therapy? Should it be saved as a last resort? Where do you place that, Dr. Chaudhary?
Well, once again, as has already been pointed out, diabetes is a varied condition. It's not one single entity. So in the type 1 diabetes, insulin is the number one treatment. However, in the common type of diabetes that we see, type 2 diabetes, insulin also is required in a significant proportion of individuals, and we should not delay it too long because this may end up in development of untreatable or irreversible complications. And that's a huge price to pay.
So I think a very important point, again, all specialists, all endocrinologists, all diabetologists believe that insulin should be used for diabetes as and when indicated. So please don't run away from insulin if your doctor has advised you to use it. There's one other area, moving to a totally different sphere of treatment, you know, which is especially relevant for Asian communities, especially India. And that is the use of alternative therapies, non-allopathic therapies, non-Western therapies, if you may. Dr. Joshi, you have some experience with that. You have some comments to make on use of alternative therapies for diabetes management.
So I think there is nothing like an alternative therapy for diabetes. It's complementary therapy. And that's the right term to use. And I think we need to be very cautious. In type 1 diabetes, the treatment is replacement with insulin because insulin is what our body needs. In type gestational diabetes, again, it's insulin. In secondary diabetes, again, it is insulin. But in type 2 diabetes, in pre-diabetes or early type 2 diabetes, some of these bioactives can be used. But they need systematic evidence under scientific scrutiny. In fact, the longest surviving and the best anti-diabetic drug today is metformin. What is metformin? 200 years back, it is a plant-based extract from France. That is Sadafuli, which is a plant which is available in India. And that has been systematically researched, and they crystallized guanidine derivatives. From that guanidine derivatives, they made metformin, and we use it. So, in fact, most of the allopathic medicines which we are using today are extracts either of plant-based medicine or are actually chemically derived. But they are not harmful. They are equally useful. So, I think there is a role for complementary medicines with bioactives, with systematic research to be needed. Particularly in pre-diabetes area or in early diabetes of type 2, it may be useful. But the only word of caution is that in type 1 diabetes or sure. people whose pancreas don't make insulin, insulin is the natural treatment for diabetes.
One of the concerns that many individuals have is or that allopathic medicines have side effects. The alternative medicines do not have side effects.
That's not true. Because the effectiveness may be there for both, but that has not been systematically studied in a randomized controlled fashion. And the safety and pharmacovigilance for complementary medicines is equally important.
Yes,
many of them have metals, many of them have steroids, and that has to be systematically absolutely. Documented. So we need so to use an evidence-based path,
really,
whether it's
yes,
complementary medicine or allopathic.
I thank you. I think the panel is pretty much in sync on that. It's okay to use these therapies maybe in very early or pre-diabetic or prevention stage, but they need more systematic study. And we cannot presume that they are safe unless we have proper clinical trial data as we have for the other molecules that we use commonly. So I think that's an important point. And you know, when we talk of treating diabetes with all these measures, Dr. Wangnu, there's one fact we haven't discussed. One aspect we haven't discussed, and that is really about the role of the patient. You know, do you think that diabetes can be managed by all of us prescribing the right medicines, whether it's insulin or whether it's tablets, or do you think the patient needs to be empowered? What is your view on that?
It's not the only the doctor's prescription which is going to help the patient. Patient empowerment means the patient should be knowledgeable enough, patient should be aware, patient should know all yeah. the aspects of the diabetes and its complication over a period of time. So if we tell the patient, patient should be his own doctor, and he should know each and every aspect of diabetes, whether it's diet, exercise, the pills he has to take it, what kind of complications he is going to develop in the, over the long term, how to detect the early detection of complications so that you can manage them at the right time, so you can delay the onset of complications.
So the importance of patient empowerment is brought out very clearly here. You know, we sometimes say that treating diabetes or relationship between a diabetes specialist and the patient is that of a coach and a player.
Absolutely.
So whatever Anil Kumble might do, it's Virat Kohli who has to deliver. So on this note, we'll take a short break and we'll be back with you with much more interesting information. As we know, diabetes is a lifestyle disease that impacts the whole family. So, Dr. Zargar, especially in the Indian environment, what do you say about the role of family in management of diabetes?
As Dr. Wangnu very aptly said, patient needs to be empowered. I would say that this concept needs to be expanded to the whole family. Because this is a family, you know, when you talk about diet, when you're talking about lifestyle, probably it means that there might be something wrong at the familial level with
absolutely.
The lifestyle. The whole absolutely. Family needs to correct that lifestyle in terms of whatever time they spend on exercise, whatever time, the way they cook their food, the way their daily food habits are. So it's a great opportunity that the whole family creates a healthy diet atmosphere, you know, healthy eating
environment. That's fantastic, Dr. Zargar. I think that's a great point.
Extremely important, rather than isolating this one individual. And in fact, it might also help us in putting some brakes on that huge epidemic of diabetes that we have in our own country.
So use the patient as an index, really, to modify lifestyle for the whole family. Great message. Dr. Joshi, there's a lot of talk about weight and diabetes. And do you think people can cure their diabetes by losing weight?
Well, we are thin fat Indians, so we have more fat, and therefore if you lose weight, your sugars will get under control, that's for sure. But there is no cure, it is control. Remember one thing, 2-year results, 5-year results don't make you cure. So don't get carried away by these false claims. Lose weight, stay healthy, reduce and chop off your fat, your glucose will be under control.
Great. Another challenge that all of us face, you know, is that patients will come once for a prescription. Now, do you think patients need to come to the doctor regularly or be in touch regularly? You want to talk about that?
Yeah, unfortunately, the answer is yes. For a condition that's lifelong, it has to be a periodic monitoring, periodic consultation. And because the condition is progressive, it's not static, so one-time prescription will not do. And I would suggest that for an average run-of-the-mill individual with diabetes, which is who is even reasonably controlled at this point of time from all aspects, at least twice in a year consultation with a physician should be followed.
So what Dr. Chaudhary is telling you, it's important to remain in touch with your physician, whether you do it face-to-face, sometimes electronically, whatever method you choose. But it's good to be in touch. Don't take it as a one-off. Dr. Malani, there's always this thing about patients measuring their blood glucose, whether they should do that or not, and how frequently, and what's the role?
Yeah, the blood sugar monitoring, what you call the home monitoring of blood glucose or the self-monitoring of blood glucose, is essential part of the diabetes management. Mm. I think you cannot do away with it, because if you want to remain on the target about your blood sugar readings, you have to monitor blood sugar frequently. Frequently doesn't mean that you have to monitor sugar every day. That depends whether you're on insulin, whether you're on the pills, or you're on a diet and exercise, that your doctor will tell how frequently you have to monitor blood sugar. Because that is important to modify your treatment time to time. As Shubhankar told you, that diabetes is a progressive disease, and without monitoring, you cannot be on the target, you cannot prevent the diabetic ongoing complications. The monitoring should be on the top, and it should be mandatory to tell the patient how frequently you have to monitor depending on a doctor's advice.
But as you know, Dr. Wangnu, patients always complain that, you know, the machine is not accurate.
You're right, Amrish. Yeah, because the monitoring, they take the capillary blood, and when they do the whole blood from the laboratory, there has to be a difference around, say, 8 to 10%. But the modern glucometers have basically been calibrated more accurate towards the blood sugars.
Yes.
So you can rely upon the modern glucometer, which they have been calibrated, and that is the only tool by which you can monitor frequently. You can go to the lab quite often to do the blood sugars. So I will tell that the current glucometers are fair enough.
Empowering the
yes, absolutely. Yeah, that is real empowerment.
It is real empowerment.
To be able to see your blood glucose.
See your blood sugar and modify the treatment.
So is there any other monitoring required? If I am a diabetic, I just check my glucose and I'm happy, it's fine.
Important to know how an aggregate blood sugar is, on an average, how well a person is doing. It's like we do every 3 months a test known as hemoglobin A1C. So that, you know, if it is under the target, and then you tie them off with your own blood sugars, things are fine. Then apart from that, you know, having a look at one's own eyes, you know, looking for the complications in terms of retinopathy, one is in a year or one is in 3 years, looking at urinary proteins, how is your kidney okay, and one is in a year or two, getting a cardiac evaluation done, so that whatever damage potential a bad diabetes has, it has not been properly taken care of, the damage containment mechanisms are put in place in time. So those regular monitoring is extremely important.
Really,
pressure.
We need,
blood pressure is something very important as well. Not, you don't have to go to the labs to get your blood pressure done.
Absolutely.
That's also very important.
Absolutely.
So you know, you need to catch the complications early, and prevention is always better than cure. One other aspect is about actual lifestyle measures. You know, we say lifestyle, you know, exercise. So, Dr. Chaudhary, you want to enlighten us a little bit about what should a diabetic do? That's a diabetes patient do. They always ask this. What kind of exercise should I do?
Yeah, exercise is very important, and it's partly helps you to lose weight. But even if you do not lose weight, exercise helps you in controlling your diabetes. And so what do you do? Well, you have to find out what is convenient, what is acceptable, what is pleasurable for you. A simple measure is a brisk walk, maybe cover 3 kilometers in 40 minutes or so. That should be good for most individuals. However, for the elderly, those with arthritis, bad knees, we may have to modify. And then there would be the young and the fit who like to go for tennis thrice in a week, go for swims, which are all fine, great. Beyond these also, it's now understood that diabetes individuals with diabetes would actually benefit if they put up some form of resistance exercise, resistance training, using weights or even without weights, using your own body weight, push-ups. So all these add further to improving your control of diabetes.
So Dr. Wangnu, two brief comments. One, in all this gamut of exercise, where do you place yoga?
Yes, among all the type of the exercise, what Dr. Chaudhary told you, the yoga and meditation are equally important. Equally important in the sense, many studies done on the yoga and diabetes. They basically help to improve your lifestyle, basically. You remain a sort of a disciplined person. So you have to do yoga for half an hour or 15 minutes or 20 minutes, and it should be under supervision of a trained yoga teacher. what kind of asanas are important for you, what kind of a disease you are having associated, like arthritis, I told you, heart disease, the blood pressure. Accordingly, the asanas can be changed. So that is, I'm telling you, it has to be done under the supervision of a trained yoga teacher.
So a judicious combination of aerobic exercise, strength training, and yoga will probably help you a lot in managing your condition. And as we head towards the most contentious part, but we'll do it in very brief today, and that is diet. Dr. Joshi, you want to enlighten people, tell us something about a diet for diabetes patients.
So the biggest fads on diabetes are related to diet. And the biggest myths about it are about diet. So I have a very simple mantra. Eat less, portion control. So whatever you're eating, eat less. Make your breakfast, lunch, and dinner one third less. Eat less. Eat on time. Eating on time is equally important, particularly in urban environments, but even in rural environments. And eat less, eat on time, and eat the right food. Avoid fried food, sweets, you know, all these substances which have been told do not eat. But most people, when we tell them not to eat, we tend to eat more.
That's human nature.
It's equally important to integrate diet and eating less, eating on time, eating right, with walk more, sleep on time, sleep adequately, and smile. Yoga actually is the word, A is silent in yoga. And therefore, it's important that it's a lifestyle, but food is a sensorial pleasure. When you start thinking of food, you want to eat more.
Yes.
You need to do something called as mindfulness.
Yes.
When you think and you see food, you have to be mindful to control that portion. So if you eat less, eat on time, eat the right food, avoid sweets, dry fruits, fried food, fast food, simple things.
So I think
if you do simple things and keep it simple, we can do a lot. And diet has more myths, more internet, more blogs than anything around. But the most simple mantra people forget is to eat less, eat on time, and eat right.
So wonderful gyan from Absolutely. Dr. Joshi. And just to conclude this, one last brief point from Dr. Zargar, and that's about this thing about artificial sweeteners, because somebody's going to ask that, so you might as well answer.
Absolutely. You know, first thing on, you know, briefly, first, whenever we give a diet counseling, first, what's important is what are the patient's own preferences. And, you know, in our own country, people like lot of meat, as you very rightly said it. And is there a substitute to that? You know, getting the same thing, sanitizing the same thing, but making it a bit equally meat. Yes, it's doable. In the current times, you have very safe sweeteners available. I don't find much problem in that. And it, in fact, might add a bit of a quality to the life of the patient, because he is now doing what he is pleasurable to him. As Shashank was saying, you know, it should also be a pleasant activity. It should not be, food should not become like taking a medicine. It should continue to give the pleasure that one would have.
Absolutely.
And this might add that pleasant pleasure to it.
But I will say one thing. This should be avoided in pregnant ladies and the small children,
sure,
basically.
Sure.
That
Live
should be
judicious,
judicious use of the artificial sweetener.
So I think the we come to the end of the discussion today with the message that you need to maintain a good quality of life in diabetes. Don't get overpowered by the condition. Control diabetes. Use basic, normal advice from your doctor. Don't go for fad diets. Don't go for any extreme measures. By and large, since 40% of us in the metros at the age of 60 are diabetic, I think all of us need to learn to live with diabetes. That will help us and our families lead healthier and longer lives. Thank you.